is its Saxon name, the Isle of Wight, and 1.25 million Britons choose it for their annual dose of sun and relaxation. And so mild is its climate that it's taken only 7 years to make this exotic botanic garden, called Steep Hill, on cliffs above the resort of Ventnor. Trees and shrubs from sunspots of the world are thriving already, from Australasia and Central America, Southern Africa and China. They include the inevitable palm, beloved by Victorian holidaymakers. This is a Victorian island. The Victorians built the resorts of Shanklin here and Sandown 2 miles away, twins which still lure most of the island's family holidaymakers. From beyond Shanklin Pier to the white cliffs of Culver are 7 miles of sands, backed by downlands, putting greens, children's playgrounds. There are hotels and guest houses of almost every shape, size and price. This is a seaside holiday straight out of the picture books, complete with piers. Victorians loved piers. Sadly, most are in decay, but here they're thriving. Sandown's pier has had a facelift, a theatre modernised for modern shows, and sun lounges alongside where you can sit and watch the sea in any weather. Many hotels are a genuine stone's throw from the beach. This hotel is family-owned and family-run for families on holiday. It costs £63 a week for adults, full board, £33 for under-7s, £44 for under-12s. The old fishing village of Shanklin has blessedly survived the invasion of motor traffic, although it takes speed and vigilance for pedestrians to survive on its corners. It is now blatantly a tourist showplace. Its thatched cottages are restaurants, tea rooms and souvenir shops. But its 18th century coaching inn is still a hotel with updated musical entertainment. Well, dance bars and discos seem as essential a part of a modern resort as Pierrot shows were in Grandad's days. But some things don't change. The thatched crab inn still serves crab sandwiches bulging with fish caught by local boats.
Oh, excuse me. Very good, though.
In the Isle of Wight, deep ravines cut by streams in the cliffside are called chines, and this one joins Old Shanklin Village to the beach 330 feet below. Once it was used by smugglers. Now it's a sanctuary for wild birds, badgers and foxes, and you can wander its wooded paths alongside the streams and small waterfalls. Bonchurch on the edge of Ventnor was a favourite spot for Victorian villas. Well, this beautiful house, Winterbourne, so captivated Charles Dickens that in 1849 he moved his family here, enthusing in letters to friends about this beautiful garden, with a waterfall which he used as a shower after bathing. "I think it is the prettiest place I ever saw in my life, at home or abroad," he wrote. And in a big room looking towards the sea, he wrote much of David Copperfield. But Dickens found the air at Ventnor far too relaxing. He couldn't work, he said. Now, Winterbourne is an elegant hotel, and guests come here to relax, not work. The room where Dickens wrote is now the dining room, and dinner by candlelight is served in these elegant surroundings. Half board here costs from £84 a week. Westfield, just round the corner, was built in the 1830s for Queen Adelaide, wife of William IV. Now it contains holiday apartments, with purpose-built holiday bungalows in its 14-acre grounds. Self-catering is overtaking hotels and guest house holidays as elsewhere. There are scores of holiday centres on Wight, lively and quiet. This one is relaxed, though there is dancing and cabaret each night. Bungalows are carpeted and have all you need for a family holiday, from pots and pans to putters and golf balls for the miniature course opposite. The children's playground is safe from traffic, and there is a bar, restaurant and swimming pool. If the sun fails you, you can soak in a sauna and tan in a solarium. An apartment for six people costs £126 a week in peak season. But bargain spring and autumn holidays for motorists include an apartment plus fares for a car and six people on the Southampton Cowes ferry for £60 a week. The Isle of Wight paddle steamers ply no more. Faster ferries operate from Southampton, Portsmouth and Lymington in Hampshire, and hovercraft and hydrofoils from Southampton. With time, the right weather and money, you can have a learn-to-fly holiday at Bembridge, a package holiday.
Well, David Cowan, your chief flying instructor here, how long will it take to learn to fly?
It takes at least 4 weeks.
And what does the course consist of?
It consists of 35 flying hours, a minimum of, and 15 ground instructional hours with navigation, meteorology, etc.
Do you have to have any qualifications yourself before you come onto the course?
You just need a medical, which is conducted by a civil aviation authority authorised doctor on the island before you can fly solo.
Mm. And what qualifications do you get when you've done the course?
When you finish, you get a private pilot's licence, which entitles you to fly any British registered aircraft virtually anywhere in reasonable weather.
Mm. And do you have to keep in practice?
Yes, you do. You need to do 5 flying hours within 13 months.
Mm. Right, well, this is a lovely little plane, so shall we go?
Yes, let me pass your headset.
Right.
Here we are. If you'd like to put that on, we'll just go through the checks.
It costs around £18 an hour to learn flying, so if you pack in the full 35 hours, it'll set you back £630. But remember, that does not include your bed and board over the 4 weeks you have to set aside to get your licence. Of course, you can take to the skies for a good deal less than that, but strictly as a passenger. A 30-minute flip around the island costs £8. You can use it to start planning next year's holiday. Along White's 60 miles of meandering coastline, you can take your choice of scene and recreation. Long stretches of truly soft sand for sunbathing. Hideaway coves for swimming. High chalk downs for walking. Fishing harbours. Creeks and inlets which once made White a paradise for smugglers and now make it a paradise for sailors. This isle is Britain's sailing capital. In summer, there's a regatta at least once a week. The relaxed way to see the island is by bus, and you can buy a week's unlimited travel on both buses and trains for less than £6. However they travel, most visitors will make a point of getting themselves to Osborne House, the island home of Queen Victoria and her beloved Albert. As a child, she'd loved the island, and when she wanted a country hideout to relax with her family around her, Albert designed this house with the help of the builder Thomas Cubitt.
She loved her children, but Victorian parents were allowed privacy, and Mama and Papa could retire to their private suite. Albert's dressing and writing room, with his walking sticks, desk, and macabre marble sculptures of their children's limbs. In the Queen's homely, cluttered sitting room, they sat side by side to deal with dispatches, listened to guest pianists playing on a French piano, of which not only the keys were made of ivory, and stood on the balcony together to listen to the nightingale.
The Queen's bath was the latest model, with no taps, a shower alongside, and a door to hide it. Her loo was disguised as furniture too. In the royal bedroom, Albert slept with his fob watch and a portrait of himself as a knight on his side of the bed.
When he died in 1861, Victoria retired in grief to this home which had given them so much happiness and left everything as Albert had left it, even his ticking fob watch. Well, the Queen died in this bed in 1901. Osborne was not Edward VII's style, and he gave it to the nation, but asked that his mother and father's private rooms be locked up. They stayed so, behind this gate, for 50 years, until the present Queen gave permission to open them to the public. Victoria might not have approved of holidaymakers stomping round her loved home, but might have been amused by their casual clothes. And even when she bathed from her machine, she could only use a few square feet of water behind a decorous curtain which went all the way round. In happier days, the royal children had their own house, Swiss Cottage, with a kitchen where the princesses cooked meals which Ma and Pa and the boys stoically ate. Modern children have no Swiss cottage, but they do have Robin Hill, an 80-acre playground of planned freedom. And here they can meet some 150 different species of animals. There are spotted deer and wallabies, there are kids and goats, there are rabbits, there are bright and talkative birds. They even have a boa constrictor. John Roberts, you're in charge of the animals here. What is this creature like?
He's extremely tame. He's only about 5 years old, and we've had him for many years.
But does he bite?
Not at all. Put him around your neck.
This is something I've never done before.
Well, he only wants to squeeze you.
Oh, where do I hold him? Like that?
Like that, anywhere you like.
John, what an experience. Actually, in the future, I think I'm going to stick to donkeys.
If you're young and adventurous, you can drive a tank in battle. Or command a boat. And if all this action makes you hungry, you can join the barbecue for bangers and fish, while the thirsty adjourn to the bar.
I said that the Isle of Wight was for relaxation, but people have different ways of relaxing. Some unwind quicker on a commando assault course than lounging on a beach. Mandy the monkey is queen of the commando. She's a real swinger. Well, if you call that relaxation, you can tell it to the Marines.